Sounds, music, radio, podcasts. Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now.
You are now about to witness.
From Radio 2, unbelievable tales of pop trivia. Things you didn't know about pop. With Scott Mills.
Just listen.
Hello and welcome to Things You Didn't Know About Pop, the podcast which explores the careers of musical artists through the objects that help shape them. So far on the series, we've covered some incredible stories. Britney Spears' Tinky Winky doll.
Stormzy's stab vest.
Yep. Ed Sheeran's looper pedal.
Lizzo's flute.
Yes. And the time the band Idols pressed human ashes into vinyl. A story you will not believe. Today, Vic Hope is with me.
Hi, Scott.
Hey, and we're talking about something that changed the life of Amy Winehouse.
I cheated myself.
Okay, I've got a hardback book that is published by Taschen. It's called 1000 Pinup Girls, and on the front cover of it, there is quite a Marilyn Monroe-esque lady reclining. She's got a leg up in the air. She's got strappy heels on, quite a sheer dress that's off the shoulder. Her boobs are quite voluptuous. She's got a flower in her mouth, and she's wearing suspenders.
You don't need to, but you would ace it on QVC. I went for a job interview there once, and I couldn't do it. They were like, now you're going to talk about this pen.
Just say what you see.
For 10 minutes. I just can't do it as well as you just did. Now, by the time she died at just 27 years old, Amy Winehouse was an icon. Her beehive hair, her lip piercing and retro tattoos. But wind the clock back just a few years to October 2003 and the release of her debut album, Frank, and you probably wouldn't have glanced twice if she walked past you on the street.
She's wearing that off-the-shoulder fuchsia top, which was like really, really popular at the time because everyone was doing fame dressing around then for some reason. We were all in off-the-shoulder.
Yeah.
And I guess because she was at Brit school, she probably was doing the same.
When I walk in your shoes, I understand a man confused. That must have been.
Do you remember where you were when you first heard Amy?
Yeah, I feel like Amy Winehouse not only soundtracked so many moments in my life, but her entire brand accompanied so many moments. I remember where I was when she died.
Yeah.
I remember how it made me feel. But I remember when she first came out and thinking, ooh, Joss Stone's got something to worry about.
Yeah.
And that was the weird type of thoughts I had at the time.
No, but that was at the time.
I remember,
you know,
thinking her voice was just, I wasn't sure if it was real. I was like, is she putting this on?
Yeah.
How can this girl who looks like this sound like that?
Agreed. It almost didn't match.
It didn't match. And for some reason now, when I hear artists who don't look like how they sound, I wouldn't think twice about it. I know that that's music. I know that that's vocals. I know that that's branding. But back then, I literally couldn't believe it. I was flabbergasted. And I remember hearing Frank. And at the time, I was doing a lot of contemporary dance at school and ballet. I remember hearing a few songs on that album. And my first thought was, I can't wait to choreograph dances to these because they're so evocative. They're storytelling, but they're also rhythmic. I can imagine an audience being really enraptured on so many different levels, on a visceral level, on an audio level. And you can tell a story and you can really feel it. It was just beautiful.
And really hard to pigeonhole. No one could really get their head around what it was.
I think that might be why it lent itself so well to contemporary dance. Because what are you doing? Like, let's be fair, no one can get their head around what that is either.
Yeah. Her first Brit nomination for Best Urban Act perhaps sums up how difficult it was to find a box for Amy. Sounds Afro-American, is British Jewish, looks sexy, won't play up to it, is young, sounds oldish, sings sophisticated, talks like that.
Yeah.
Musically mellow, lyrically nasty. It's hard to find that box.
And I wonder if that would have been such a problem if she wasn't a woman, because women are far more often put in boxes. You have to be something, you have to be able to define it, because it's a way of controlling and knowing what we're working with. And I always say this, you know, women can be not just anything, but also everything. And Amy Winehouse was that woman.
Her home life was equally hard to pin down. Her parents separated when she was 9, and she lived with her mum Janice, staying at her dad's in Essex at the weekend.
That much seen no bra you bought me last Christmas.
Put it in the box, put it in the box.
just take it. Take the bus. Take the bus.
Now, one of the strongest influences on Amy was her paternal grandmother, Cynthia, who was a singer in her youth and who dated the English jazz musician Ronnie Scott. It was also Cynthia who first suggested Amy should go to stage school. It's that classic thing of the person in your family or close to you who spots what you could be or what you are before you do.
It's true. And grandmas are so often it. Nans do that.
My nan was the same.
Nans want more for you than you want for yourself. My parents discouraged me from going to Cambridge. They were like, don't apply. You're going to be disappointed. They were doing it because they care. And they were like, no, you're going to be upset when you don't get in. Whereas it was my grandma who was like, well, I can't wait to go to that graduation ceremony. Yeah. I'll be there on the top table in my gown.
Yeah, they kind of have none of the fear factor, nans. Yeah. Whereas, because with my mum and dad, they were like, oh, are you sure?
You.
Yeah, but like, are you sure you want to do this? It's really hard to get into that kind of work and that world. My nan was like, go for it.
So there was like 150 kids in this school, you know, the whole school. And it was just lovely. It's like a family, you know, with that amount of people. It's not like, you know, everyone in the whole school, you know, and everyone was kind of cool.
But at what point did you realise that actually it was music that was going to be your thing?
I think I realised that it was music, over musical theatre when, after I went to the Brit School, that had cemented it because I did musical theatre there and I would sing a song, like a musical theatre song, like, you know, any jazz standard from a musical and the singing teacher would be like, okay, now sing it in the style of Les Mis. I think that was when I realised that it wasn't for me, you know.
Now, Cynthia was such a strong influence on Amy that she decided to get her immortalised in ink. Amy already had a few tattoos, including a Native American feather on her forearm, an image of the cartoon character Betty Boop on her lower back, and an Egyptian symbol between her shoulder blades. But she wanted something that stood out. Amy's tattoo artist, Henry Haight, says, "She came into my shop one Monday, about 20 minutes before closing time. I remember thinking it was strange because I had just bought her CD, Frank, because I liked the track Stronger Than Me.
You should be stronger than me. You've been here 7 years longer than me."
Sitting on a store at his shop counter, Amy appeared to be tearing pages from one of Haight's favourite books, the expensive Tashin publication, 1,000 Pinup Girls. And that's the object you have in front of you right now. She was looking for a cruder, traditional tattoo, with not a lot of detail and none of the modern styling. She used phrases like va-ba-boom and images of Sophia Loren, along with other dark-haired, earthy pin-ups from that era, to get across what she wanted.
She really popularised them, didn't she? I remember so many girls in my school all of a sudden getting tattoos because Amy Winehouse got tattoos.
Yeah.
But it wasn't how it is now, where everyone just gets something because it's normal to be inked. They really felt like they could express their identity through these drawings on their body. And that's something that I don't think any of us had realised before Amy. Like, this was her identity. This was a part of it. She was telling stories through cartoons. At the time, it was more girls than boys in our school who had tattoos. And it was because they felt they had a story to tell. And she was definitely the reason they did that.
Sort of the beginning of tattoos having an actual meaning rather than just like, here's a rose or here's a butterfly.
Yeah, a potent time, because then it went back the other way and they stopped having any meaning. I mean, I've got the Lib Dem logo 3 times on my ribcage. It wasn't supposed to be that. That's just how it turned out. And now I've got it.
What can I do?
What can I do?
I don't know how you fix that. I mean, I used to know one of the tattoo fixers from E4. I mean, I could ask them.
I honestly, I don't want it fixed. It wasn't supposed to be that. It was supposed to be 3 doves for my 3 brothers, 3 little birds. But the tattoo artist just wasn't that creative. And that's what he gave me.
I learn so much more about you every time we do one of these.
You should be stronger than me. You should be stronger than me. To be stronger than me.
In May 2006, during the recording of Back to Black, Cynthia died. Those close to Amy, her father Mitch included, believed Cynthia's death may have contributed to her spiralling substance abuse. Her second album, Back to Black, was released in October 2006. The cover features Amy sitting on a stool with her tattoo of Cynthia proudly visible on her arm. She was one of those people you could recognise from her silhouette.
Oh yeah, I remember seeing her silhouette on a stamp. I don't think it was an official stamp. I feel like it was just some merchandise. But you're right, and it was just a silhouette. You totally could.
We only settled by the words.
Her life spiralled. Bookies even began taking bets over whether she would show up to her gigs after she cancelled an appearance at Tea in the Park, citing exhaustion, and was then spotted in a pub instead.
Well, we've only ever bet on this type of thing once before, and that was all about Amy, and it was whether she would turn up to a gig in Liverpool after missing an enormous number over the preceding 2 weeks. And we bet that time that she wouldn't turn up was our favourite. Sure enough, every bet was for her not turning up, and she didn't make it on the night. So we're taking absolutely no chances this time around, and we're going to go with this very short price that she doesn't turn up.
You forget what a cultural phenomenon Amy Winehouse bashing was.
It was, yeah. I feel like we were all so complicit and we thought nothing of it. Making fun of somebody being drunk or high or in pain.
How many tattoos have you got and which one's your favourite one?
Oh, that's a good question. I've got 12 or 13 and my favourite one is probably the one for my grandma. My grandma passed away last year and it means a lot to me.
I never really considered how she felt.
No.
In spite of the fact that those images of her covered in blood or stumbling out of a bar, that was normal.
Those were the ones that really still stick with me now. I think it was at the front page of a tabloid,
yeah.
And the her and Blake and the cuts on the feet.
Yeah.
And it was horrific.
I remember which awards show was it where they were making jokes or about her being drunk or about whether she would be sober at this point or whether she'd turn up, and everyone's laughing.
She annoys me because she's got no respect for her fans. You know what I mean? She doesn't turn up. I mean, she does turn up, she's late, and she blames things like sore throats. And I think it's disgraceful. She's unprofessional, unreliable. She's got a wonderful voice and a great talent, and she's blown it.
Isn't that enough, though?
No, it's not enough. You've got to respect your fans. You've got to turn up. You've got to do the work. You know, if you're advertising somewhere, you turn up and do it. You don't say, oh, I'm sorry, I slipped on a pool of vomit or whatever. And I think it's disgraceful, and she gets on my nerves. I do love her. You know what I mean? She infuriates me with the way she behaves. She really does, and she's going to kill herself on a fan. That's the saddest thing. I really do. I really do. She is good, you know, she's got a brilliant voice, and it's sad what you see what she's doing to herself.
I feel like that was the last, her and Russell Brand, which was about the same time, them being addicts and out of control, and that being just a normal part of rock and roll, because that's how it is, which it had been for a long time.
Yep.
I feel like they were the last of that before
Agreed.
We realised that actually people are dying.
Yeah.
And we can't consider that to be entertainment. That's not just showbiz.
And this is a woman who has a song called Rehab, you know?
Well, after she died, all of those songs, I remember re-listening to them and being like, she was telling us.
Same.
She was literally telling us and we didn't see it. It was hiding in plain sight. She couldn't have made it more clear what she was going through, and we didn't take it seriously. She told us.
The singer Amy Winehouse was found dead at her home in North London this afternoon. She was 27. Her second album, Back to Black, won her 5 Grammy Awards. But despite the acclaim she received for her music, her life was often troubled. She appeared drunk on stage at times, and her increasingly erratic behaviour meant she was often featured in the tabloid papers.
Her gravestone in a Jewish cemetery in North London is shared with her grandmother Cynthia, the inspiration for her most famous tattoo. Her passing led to an outpouring of love. A mural appeared near her house, and a statue was erected in her home borough, Camden. And that beloved tattoo of Cynthia's image lives on. Fans around the globe have copied it on their own skin. It still adorns the posthumous releases of Amy's material. And although he has no time for copycat images, hate has allowed some of the tattoo sketches and designs he created with Amy to go on show at the Jewish Museum in London. And now the